Let's dig deeper now into the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund, which President Marcos has pitched to investors in the U.S. We're joined by Alex Escucha. He's the president of the Institute for Development and Economic Analysis, or IDEA. Alex, hi. Thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you for having me, Ron.
Now, we want to get your thoughts on the recent statements of the newly appointed head of the MIC. First, we had an admission that the funds that it currently has will not be enough to fund any big ticket item. Does that worry you that the much touted fund of this administration, which is supposed to accelerate economic development of the country, does not have enough gas to jumpstart itself yet?
In the first place, I think that's a wrong expectation. Mm-hmm. In the experience of many countries, remember there are already 40 countries that have set up their own strategic investment funds. What they provide is seed money. Joel Consing has correctly pointed out that I also have this list of 194 infrastructure projects, which has now become a list of 197. Mm-hmm. And in that list is clearly indicated which ones are to be funded by the budget or the General Appropriations Act, which ones would be funded by low-cost funding of 1 to 2% from ODA, which ones could be partnered with the PPP, and which ones would be potential projects for Maharlika. I think it would be wrong to even think that Maharlika is an answer to everything. That is not the case. These total 194 projects in the five-year plan is about 8.3 trillion pesos, equivalent to about 5 to 6% of GDP every year. So the idea is just to help in the funding of that, those projects that are, number one, not funded by the budget, two, not funded by official development assistance, three, those that are already being pursued under the PPP program.
Alex, I'm just using the words of the government itself. It's the one who's saying that this is going to be jump-starting economic development in the country. But you did mention you're classifying this as a strategic investment fund, when others still call it a sovereign wealth fund. Will you be able to give us the difference between the two?
Correct. I think that is the basic starting point. Many people still have the wrong notion that we can start a strategic fund only when you have wealth like Norway, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, or Dubai. There are 40 countries in the world that have already put up strategic investments funds out of scarcity, meaning they don't have the surplus wealth.
It's not coming from surplus.
And in fact, there are 20 countries in the last 3 years that have set it up, driven precisely by COVID-related fiscal constraints. Mm-hmm. In that sense, the key question to me is, how is Joel Consing more qualified than most? In the first place, he is not a banker or a fund manager, because if you have a wealth fund, then you need a fund manager or a banker. But precisely, the strategic investment fund is going to be devoted to development goals precisely for infrastructure funding. And in this context, I have written elsewhere that ICTSI is an infrastructure long-term play with 32 terminals in 9 countries in 6 continents. And in that sense, Mr. Consing is very much qualified with a good fit for precisely what is the mandate of the Strategic Investment Fund.
Okay, Alex, I'm going back to another statement of Mr. Consing. He's saying that they may have to sell government assets to raise the funds for the MIF, which was included in the plan. And he did say that he was going to use a mix of cash and government properties for this. But the administration is bent on pushing this fund and, of course, rooting for its success. if it does need more funds, aside from selling government assets, where could it best get more of it?
In the first place, that's nothing new. The capital contributions of Land Bank and DBP and the national government is just the first three of the items.
Right.
In the rest of the law and in the IRR specifically mentions that sale of assets from privatization, a certain percent up to 10% of PAGPOR and other gaming revenues will be part of the future funding to start with the MIF.
Mm-hmm.
But the second key point, Ron, is that you don't really need to put up all of those in the first place. I would like to put it this way. You have to stand before you can walk, and you have to walk before you can run. What do I mean by that? To stand means you have to organize the board properly, get the proper people, because the investors are looking, do we have the right people put in place there? That's the first item for credibility. Standing to me means you have to put in the investment committee. In fact, Joel Consing, I agreed in my second column in the business world, one of the committees that is not in the law or in the IIR but is very important is the investment committee. And Joel Consing precisely mentioned that, because when you're talking about long gestation projects, you need an investment committee to do to screen mm-hmm. these projects for commercial returns. The Indonesian Investment Authority has precisely that. The Indian Infrastructure Investment Authority has that.
Okay, speaking of returns, the MIC chief also saying that a minimum 10% return on investment is feasible for the fund. Are you as optimistic as he is for it, given the current economic headwinds?
Well, I wouldn't go that far, but in terms of the experience in other countries, because this is you're looking at a two-level return analysis. The law says, and the IRR says, you're talking only of high-impact projects. Mm-hmm. And there are two layers here. First, the first layer of screening is that the economic and social returns have to be established, and that is through the screening by NEDA.
Yeah.
The second layer of returns is the commercial returns, where there are cash flows and yields that would make it attractive to the commercial and private investors. You're basically talking of, say, tollways and airports and highways. And in Australia, the Macquarie Infrastructure Group has decades of experience on this. In other words, this is what we call a double bottom line objective, which by definition, a strategic investment fund is supposed to achieve. A basic social returns to the economy, and a commercial return that could be attractive to the private investors. But in terms of the experience in other countries, the first set of investors are actually not private investors. In the case of India and even in Nigeria, their first partners are actually fellow strategic investment funds like the Mubadala of Kuwait or the Alaskan Permanent Fund, you know, or even the New Zealand Teachers Fund. These are very long-term investors. We're not talking here of the kind of investors we talk about in the market edge where they could move in and out of the market at the slightest risk or interest rate differentials. We're not talking of that market segment at all.
Right. Mr. Consing said that he wants to do a roadshow to pitch this to several countries, of course, businesses. What do you think would be the best selling point, Alex, when he goes around pitching the Maharlika Investment Fund?
Well, a roadshow at some point is always a good thing to communicate. In fact, in my 30 years with China Bank, the previous 15 years has been spent doing roadshows to investors. But having said that, I would like to cite the experience, for example, of the Ireland Margaret Infrastructure Fund. this is not even Ireland itself. It's set up by the European Fund for Energy, Climate Change and Infrastructure, and started by six countries. Mm-hmm. Five countries: France, Germany, Italy, Spain, and Poland. From my point of view, and this will be the topic of my third column on Maharlika, how to start with credibility. As I said a while back, you start by having the proper organization. Two, you have the right combination of board of directors with variety of experience. So you have the very different views that sort of feed on each other. Number three, you have to put in place mechanisms that will really make it credible. In my article, I mentioned that there should be a related party transactions committee. This is equivalent to what the Indonesian Investment Authority has when they have an ethics committee in the board, overseeing the board. No? And even in the Norwegian fund, they have a combined audit and risk committee. And these committees, best practice globally, and according to the Santiago principles, say that the chairman of these independent committees, audit, risk management, compliance, and related party, should be an independent director, and the majority of the members should be independent directors. Mm-hmm. These are the things that partners and investors look for. Because if that is, these pieces are in place, I think that is a very good step, foundational step, to establish that you are really serious about being transparent and being credible.
So credibility is going to be key. The president of the Institute for Development and Economic Analysis, Alex Escucha. Alex, thank you very much for your thoughts.
Thank you.